This is the moment of triumph for every bread baker, a stunning loaf of bread. And what we're all looking forward to is this. That sound is the promise of a glorious crispy crust, but it's a promise that is often broken. In just a few hours, the bread crust changes drastically. And just like that, the magic is gone. The crust has gone from glassy and brittle to leathery and soft. I know I'm not the only one frustrated by this, and without any solutions, it can feel like a fleeting, crispy crust is just an unavoidable part of baking. But what if it's not? What if there are some secret tips for us home bakers to create a crust that stays crispy for longer? Well, get ready, because that's exactly what we're diving into today. Hey, Seraphin here, and if you know me, you know I've always been a big fan of crispy breads. As a kid, one of my favorite things to eat wasn't a bag of chips or a box of candy, it was a baguette. Specifically, the crunchy edge of the baguette. I'd be satisfied eating it plain, just chomping away at the crusty bread. So now that I can make my own bread, whether it's baguettes, ciabatta, or other artisan breads, a crispy crust is a good crust in my book. But I've always had one problem with every crispy bread recipe I've made. You see, I live on a tropical island surrounded by the sea, which is as beautiful as it is humid, extremely humid more often than not. And when you live in a place with an average relative humidity of over 80%, you quickly realize crispy bread is a very fleeting concept. The crispiness of bread is less of a fact and more of a blip in time, gone before you know it. This has always just been something that I accepted. I can bake my bread for an hour and try various recipes, but that elusive crispiness will essentially vanish before the bread even cools down. Until now, using a bit of science and a few baking attempts, I think I've found some easy ways as a home baker to help prolong the crispiness even in my humid climate. If you live in a drier climate, then these tips would be even more handy in prolonging the crispiness of your bread crust. It is, of course, impossible to entirely stop the bread crust from softening, but I'm already quite satisfied with the idea of not burning my mouth when I eat my crispy bread. And all these methods are super simple to do. Before we get into the meat of this video, let's talk a little more about crispiness itself. Putting in a bit of historical context, our love for crispy and crunchy foods has been said to stem from our ancestors, who were probably looking for fresh vegetables or fruits that hadn't gone bad. Like how a fresh carrot snaps into two with a sharp sound, crispness is often a sign of freshness in natural products. And while bread is entirely different from foods like carrots and leafy greens, this fact is also pretty true for bread. Crispy bread is often freshly baked bread, because just a few hours after baking, the crispiness of the crust often disappears. Which is a shame, because the studies show that a crispy crust really does make bread taste better, releasing more volatile compounds in the mouth. So then, what causes this loss of crispiness in the first place? As it turns out, the main culprit is water, specifically water migration. If you saw my previous video on water mobility, you know water isn't just sitting still in the dough. And the same is true after baking. Water moves from the moist crumb to the drier crust of the bread. And if your kitchen is humid, water from the air also joins the party, attacking your crust from the outside. When the crust absorbs too much water, it loses its crispiness. Think of it like this. The structure in the crust that make it brittle and glassy get plasticized, a fancy way of saying that they get soft and flexible, like going from glass to rubber. This is also part of why room humidity plays such a huge role. The higher the humidity, the faster your crust says goodbye to crispiness. Now, this is not just because the crust soaks up water faster, it's also about something called the water gradient in the crust. Ideally, you want the very outer layer of the crust to be much drier than the surface beneath it. This steep difference, or gradient, is what makes it remain crisp. So even if two crusts have the same average water content, the one with a steeper gradient will feel crispier. In low humidity, the crust mostly takes water from the crumb, which can help maintain that beneficial gradient for a bit longer, whereas high humidity evens out this difference, making the whole crust more uniformly damp and less crisp. Okay, so we know water moving into the crust is the enemy. How do we fight it? The key is to reduce how much water settles in the crust. Let's picture bread just out of the oven. The crust is super hot, well over 100 degrees Celsius, while the inside is cooler, around 90 degrees Celsius. At this point, steam is still trying to escape from the inside of the bread out through the crust. But as the crust cools below 100 degrees Celsius, that escaping steam can start to condense on the crust. This trapped moisture is our main problem. So a lot of research has looked into ways to help this water vapor escape more easily. One surprising factor is proofing time. A study on crispy rolls found that shorter proofing times led to a crispier crust that stayed crispier for longer. The idea is that a tighter crumb structure with smaller, less connected air pockets might slow down water moving from the crumb to the crust. But this presents two problems for us. First, this trick doesn't really work well if you live in a humid place. Bummer. The element of relative humidity has a much bigger influence on the speed at which the bread crust softens. So even shortening the proofing time won't allow the crust to remain crispy for that much longer. But a bigger issue for us is that artisan bread is often popular for its beautiful open crumb with big airy holes. Shorter proofing times or a tighter crumb structure would ruin that. So that method is out for many artisan breads. In the case where we can't or don't want to shorten the proofing time, we can turn our focus to the crust itself. If we can make the crust more like a breathable paper bag rather than a plastic one, more permeable to water vapor, then the steam can escape instead of making the crust soggy. And this could ultimately lead to crispiness retention. Scientists found exactly this. A more permeable crust means longer lasting crispiness. So then, how do you make a crust more permeable? Well, one paper showed researchers puncturing the dough with needles to create tiny channels for steam to escape. Obviously, we're not going to sit around poking our dough hundreds of times with a sewing needle. Alternatively, and luckily for us, these channels can appear naturally in the form of cracks on the crust surface as the bread cools. These tiny cracks act like vents, letting moisture out and keeping the crust crispier for longer. How do we encourage these good cracks? Well, you might already know the principal idea behind this if you've ever accidentally broken or cracked a cold glass by pouring something hot into it. The thermal shock that the glass receives is handled poorly by the material, causing it to crack or break. This paper hypothesized that the same thing can happen to the brittle bread crust. Now, when we talk about the bread crust, we're going to focus on two important elements here, the gluten and the starch. Gluten proteins, as you probably know, make the network that holds the dough together. But while they are very beneficial for the crumb of the bread, they are pretty detrimental to the crust for various reasons, which we'll cover in more detail later. Starch, on the other hand, doesn't form networks in the way gluten does. When you give them heat and a sufficient amount of water, starch granules swell and ultimately rupture. This phenomenon, called starch latinization, results in a thickened, viscous mixture or gel, which is the principle behind applications like porridge and tangjong. Okay, combining these facts together, research found that crusts with a good amount of gelatinized starch, around 60 to 75% was a sweet spot, and a less tightly woven gluten network were more likely to crack, especially if they experience a bit of thermal shock during cooling, like moving from a hot oven to a cooler room. The study's results were pretty good. Breads designed with crack-promoting crusts stayed crispy up to 8 times longer in the crucial first few hours. It's also quite interesting that they measured it using the sound emission made by cracking the crust. For some breads, their crust after 4 hours had a higher sound pulse than the standard breads after just 30 minutes. There is a small caveat to these results here, though. This research was done on special bread doughs, so results may vary a bit with our homemade loaves. They adjusted starch and protein ratios in ways we wouldn't typically do. But we can still glean two pretty crucial takeaways from this. First, it's definitely a good idea to move your finished bread from the oven to a preferably much cooler place, such as a wire rack or maybe even the fridge for a quick temperature shock. Bread that was left in the hot oven to slowly cool down did not form these cracks, and without the cracks, you don't get more crispiness retention. Second, the crust itself should have a relatively higher amount of gelatinized starch and a weakened gluten network to best induce more cracks. One way to do this could be to use some steam, which can increase starch gelatinization and create a crispier crust. However, it's important to keep the amount of steam added in moderation, because too much starch gelatinization is a bad thing for crust crispiness as well. At high levels, it can make the crust less permeable, and of course, we know that means the crust won't stay crispy for as long as a more permeable crust would. This links back to what I've discussed in my previous video on steam in bread baking. I won't repeat everything I said in that video, but to put it shortly, lots of steam added during baking increases starch gelatinization because of the extra water. This results in a denser crust when viewed under a microscope. While more steam can make a crust more brittle initially, it can also trap moisture in the long run, reducing how long the bread crust stays crispy. Lower steam can mean a thinner crust that is more permeable and thus remains crispy for an extended time. So there is a choice to be made with steam. If you want crispy and super crunchy bread right out of the oven, go with a high amount of steam. But if you want the crispiness to last for longer, you might want to use less steam. Okay, that was all about steam, but steam is just one way to get a crispier crust, mainly revolving around starch gelatinization. And we can also increase crispiness by focusing on another part of the crust, the gluten network. Research shows that modifying the proteins on the dough's surface can help it stay crispy by making it harder for water to be absorbed, specifically treating the dough surface with protease enzymes, which break down proteins, before baking has been shown to boost crispiness and how long it lasts. Breads treated this way stayed crispier even in high humidity, which is fantastic news. Now, what this paper has studied is basically adding protease enzymes to the outer layer of the bread. But that can be a little bit tricky for us to imitate as home bakers. So for our purposes, I've tried out a simple home baker trick to get some more protease activity on the crust. Brushing the dough surface with a little diluted sourdough starter or an over-fermented poulish before baking adds a thin layer of already broken down gluten network, and the low pH of the starter or poulish encourages protease activity, making the enzymes work faster to break down the gluten network. While it's a home experiment, it really seemed to make my bread crispier, and that crispiness lasted longer even in my humid kitchen. Beyond protease activity, the extra water added by brushing the dough with the starter or poulish could increase starch gelatinization by a little bit. Now, this trick is not applicable to all types of bread due to variations in proofing methods, but I found it to be super useful for breads like ciabatta and ciopa. Another study done on ciabattas also showed that adding protease enzymes to the dough had a great effect on crispness. In this study, they actually used a fungal protease and found that in the right amounts, it improved the crispness of the bread and let it stay crispy for longer. The paper also found that using malt increased crispness, and pairing both protease and malt resulted in better effects. To put this into practical use, if you want crispier bread, it's probably a good idea to use something like a preferment or sourdough to get more proteolytic activity throughout the dough, and maybe use some malt. However, there is a limit to how much proteolytic activity you want, because the study did find that too much protease resulted in less crispiness. So make sure to keep that in mind. Okay, other than protease and starch gelatinization, we also need to briefly cover the effect of the heating rate, or in simpler words, how quickly the dough heats up. As I covered in my previous video, this can be influenced by both oven temperature and probably elements like baking stones and the like that retain and transfer heat well. High oven temperatures, along with heat-retaining elements, will definitely allow the dough to heat up at a faster rate. This is important because higher heating rates have been linked to higher permeability and water vapor transport in the crust, which likely means a crust that stays crispier for longer. This is likely related to the fact that higher heating rates seem to result in less swollen starch granules in the crust, aka less starch gelatinization. So a key takeaway from this is that if you want a bread that stays crispier for longer, it's a good idea to bake your bread at higher temperatures and probably with elements that hold onto heat well. This fact is especially crucial for if you're baking with steam or high hydration doughs. As we wrap this video up, I think it's good to extend our perspective a little. Naturally, bread isn't just composed of the crust, and I want to briefly talk about the crumb. So far, what we've covered is that a more breathable crust is great for keeping crispiness. But while this is fantastic for the outer texture of the bread, it could lead to a drier inner crumb over time. This is one of the few downsides of increasing the permeability of the crust mentioned in the paper. The paper's solution to this was to find an optimal crust permeability. But as home bakers, we don't really have the lab equipment to determine whether or not our crust is at the optimum permeability. So I've come to a somewhat interesting idea that we might be able to use tangjong for this. Tangjong is famous for helping bread retain moisture in the crumb. And while many bakers think of tangjong as something that is strictly for soft Asian breads, I speculate that it might be the perfect ingredient here, especially since it could also help add some gelatinized starch to the crust, which, as we've mentioned, could help it remain crispier for longer. That being said, this is probably an experiment for another video. And that's it for this video. Thanks for watching, and bye!